All the movie asks is that in America, don't you have the right to have your own opinion, especially if it's a well-thought-out opinion? And why would you have a well-thought-out opinion be denounced because of your race as reflective of a sellout, of somebody who's an Uncle Tom who wishes bad things to happen to fellow members of his own race? What is the logic behind that? And why is this going on? And isn't this hurting the country? That's what the movie asks.
Are police actually using deadly force disproportionately against black people? And how does the focus on police overshadow other monumental problems facing black America today? Why is believing that Black Lives Matter not the same as supporting the Black Lives Matter organization? And why are black conservatives often excluded from mainstream public awareness and discourse? In this episode, we sit down again with radio talk show personality and best-selling author Larry Elder, who hosts The Larry Elder Show for the Epoch Times. He is the executive producer of the new documentary film, Uncle Tom. This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Yanya Kelik. Larry Elder, such a pleasure to have you back on American Thought Leaders.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it. As Charlton Heston once said to me, thank you for letting me borrow your audience. I appreciate it.
Well, because we're going to talk about Uncle Tom on your shirt, this film that we've been talking, you and I have been talking about for a while now. It's coming very, very soon.
I've been working on this film, Jan, for 2 years.
Most people are completely oblivious to the history of the Democratic Party.
The party of slavery.
The history of the Democratic Party.
Jim Crow laws.
They're erasing all of the history of this country.
They want to cover up history.
The real history, not the revisionist history.
If you are educated.
Black people have been taught.
A narrative that has been created.
You're actually miseducated.
And that's when I realized I've been lied to.
I had been misled.
It unraveled everything that I knew to be true.
Along with the director, Justin Malone. And it is about the grief that people like Candace Owens and Herman Cain and Thomas Sowell, Walter Williams, Alan West, Clarence Thomas get for simply suggesting that maybe, just maybe, the policies that blacks have been following, the Democratic policies that blacks have been voting for, the left-wing policies that blacks have been pulling that lever for, maybe, just maybe, we ought to rethink them. And it's not an angry film. It's not a film that says, how dare you call us these nasty names. It's a film that says, why can't we have an intelligent discussion about whether or not we should be supporting school choice? Why can't we have an intelligent discussion about whether or not we should be supporting Roe v. Wade? Why can't we have an intelligent discussion about whether or not we should be having stronger borders? Because the studies suggest that unskilled illegal aliens take jobs away from unskilled black and brown workers and puts downward pressure on their wages. Can we have a discussion about this without my being called an Uncle Tom, a self-loather, a sellout? Dean Baquet is the executive editor of the New York Times, happened to be black, and he hired a conservative as a columnist named Bret Stephens, a never-Trumper, the kind of conservative that the New York Times hires as a Republican. And Bret Stephens' first column had to do with his skepticism about climate change alarmism. That's all. He didn't say, I don't agree with it. I'm just saying I'm skeptical that these alarmist trends that people are predicting are going to happen. And Baquet said that people contacted the New York Times, angry that they hired this guy, angry that he wrote this column. And Baquet was surprised at the ferocity of people because he hired a conservative to write a column that, in his opinion, very intelligently raised some questions about climate change. And Baquet publicly said he found out the left, as a general rule, does not want to hear thoughtful disagreement. That's a verbatim quote. I argue that the black left doesn't even believe there's such a thing as thoughtful disagreement. And therefore, we're not having discussions in the black community that, in my opinion, are healthy and could lead to a better outcome. The number one problem in the black community is not racism. It's not bad cops, although we both know both exist. The number one problem is the large number of blacks who are raised without fathers. In 1965, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who later on became a Democrat senator from New York, wrote a paper called The Negro Family, A Case for National Action. At the time, 25% of blacks were born outside of wedlock, a number that he thought was horrific And he felt if we don't do something, take some sort of national action, this is going to get worse. Well, fast forward. Now 70% of black kids are born outside of wedlock. 25% of white kids now are. Nearly half of Hispanic kids are. And forget about Larry Elder. Barack Obama once said a kid raised without a father is 5 times more likely to be poor and commit crime, 9 times more likely to drop out of school, and 20 times more likely to end up in prison. Now, this is something that we're not even having a discussion about. And in my opinion, if you look at the proliferation of kids born outside of wedlock, it parallels the rise in social spending under the so-called war on poverty that was launched in the mid-60s. And Lyndon Johnson launched it with the best of intentions. He felt that it was going to make people more self-sufficient. All it did was create dependency. And what it's done is to incentivize women to marry the government, incentivize men to abandon their financial and moral responsibility. It is the number one social problem in America in general, and the number one social problem in the black community in particular. And we're not having that discussion. And when someone like myself or Bob Woodson, another community activist who's in the film, raises these questions, instead of this igniting a healthy discussion, people like myself are denounced and dismissed as Uncle Toms, as self-loathers. Why? And that's what the film asks. Why can't we just have an intelligent discussion? Why are you assuming that I have some sort of malintent behind it? All I'm trying to do is get people to realize their God-given potential, the same as I assume you're trying to do, and we just have a different philosophy about it. But I don't consider you to be self-loathing. I don't consider you to be a race traitor because you're advancing policies that I think hurt. Why are you making that assumption about me?
You know, it's a very fascinating time to be talking about this. I mean, it's almost kind of crazy because of this horrible killing of George Floyd that happened just a few weeks ago and the resulting protests and, frankly, a lot of very well-meaning people on the streets wanting to support black lives, mm-hmm. right? And at the same time, a lot of concerns but I've heard from a lot of people that there's only one way that's allowed to think about this. People losing their jobs, people losing, you know, careers, relationships, and so forth.
Well, the narrative is that racism remains a powerful impediment for black progress in America. Whether it's systemic racism, a term you hear a lot, or structural racism, a term you hear a lot, or institutional racism, or one that I heard Beto O'Rourke come up with, foundational racism. If America were institutionally racist, why is it that in the 50s, if you ask white people, would they ever support a black person for president, the answer was no. Fast forward, Obama got elected. He got a higher percentage of the white vote than John Kerry did. And we're talking about institutional racism. It's crazy. In 2015, Freddie Gray was died in police custody. At the time of his death, the mayor of Baltimore, black, the number one person running the police department, black, his assistant, black, all of city council, Democrat, majority black, the state attorney who brought the charges against 6 officers, black, 3 of the 6 officers charged were black, the judge before whom 2 of the officers had their cases tried was black. By the way, he found them not guilty. The U.S. Attorney General at the time, Loretta Lynch, black, and of course, the President of the United States at the time, Barack Obama, is black. So you have all these people running the institution. And I'm reminded of something that comedian Wanda Sykes said shortly after Obama got elected. And she talked about what was going to happen down the road when and if things didn't change. And she said, how are you going to complain about the man when you are the man? Well, these American cities where we have these police chiefs that are allegedly racist have been run by Democrats for decades. Democrats have picked these officers, and in many cases, the chiefs of police happen to be black. And people are still screaming about institutional racism. We're having this interview in Los Angeles. From 1992 to 2002, LA had back-to-back black police chiefs. There was a black police chief in charge during the O.J. Simpson case. And you might recall all these allegations about evidence planting and fabricating evidence and framing an innocent man. So because of all these allegations, the then police chief, Willie Williams, did a complete and total departmental review to find out if anybody had done anything wrong at all in connection with the O.J. Simpson case. This is during the trial now. Report came out, found no evidence whatsoever anybody had done anything wrong. It didn't matter. It didn't move the needle one way or the other. Those who felt that O.J. Simpson was an innocent man framed by the racist LAPD continued thinking he was an innocent man framed by the racist LAPD, even though the racist LAPD is run by a black man who just did a report that said nobody did anything wrong in connection with the O.J. Simpson case. My point is, it didn't matter. Part of the protesters are demanding diversity in our police departments. As if you have diversity, magically these problems are going to go away. In L.A., L.A. is about 40% or so Hispanic, about 30% white, a little under 10% black, the rest of it are Asian Pacific Islanders. That's exactly the percentage of the LAPD, and it's still being accused of being racist. NYPD, same thing. If you look at the racial demographics of the city and look at the demographics of the police department, they mirror each other, and still the NYPD recently, the officers are being subjected with water balloons, urine-filled water balloons, trash cans full of water thrown at them, cars set on fire. Never mind how diverse the NYPD is, the average person that the average person on the street is going to encounter will be a person of color. It doesn't matter because of this false narrative. The stats simply do not reflect the idea that the police are going after black people. If anything, the stats show the opposite. There is a economist, black economist named Roland Fryer. He teaches at Harvard. And because of all these prolific high-profile shootings, he just knew that the police were disproportionately using deadly force against black people. And he was kind of surprised that no one had done a comprehensive study to corroborate that. So he thought he would do it. And he said, the results were the most surprising of my career. Not only were the police not using deadly force disproportionately against blacks, they were more hesitant, more reluctant to pull the trigger on a black suspect than on a white suspect, presumably because they were afraid of being accused of being racist. That same result was replicated in a study published in a publication put out by the National Academy of Sciences, where researchers looked at every shooting in 2015, every shooting in 2016, same conclusion, the police were not using deadly force disproportionately against black people. Now, the reason blacks are more likely to be killed, 2.5 times more likely to be killed by a cop than a white person, is because of the crime rate, which is substantially higher in the black community than in the white community. A young black man is 8 times more likely to be a victim of homicide compared to a young white man. The number one cause of preventable homicide of young whites is accidents, like car accidents and drownings. The number one cause of death, preventable or non-preventable, for a young black man, a young black person, is homicide, almost always committed by another young black person. It's not cops killing black people, it's black people killing other black people. And according to the CDC, the rate at which cops kill blacks has declined 75% in the last 50 or 60 years, while the rate at which police kill whites has flatlined. So arguably, if anybody has anything to complain about, it's white people. Because if you look at the crime rates, one would have thought that the rate at which police kill blacks would be even higher. If anything, the cops are hesitant, as I mentioned by these studies, to use deadly force against a black person because of a fear of being accused of being racist. Now, 9 unarmed black men were shot and killed by the police, according to the Washington Post last year. 19 unarmed whites were shot and killed by the police last year. Altogether, 15 unarmed blacks. And that number is still smaller than the 19 unarmed whites who were shot and killed. And if there's a White Lives Matter protest that arranged, I'd never heard about it. It is not happening. And isn't this good news? That's the other thing about my movie I tried to stress. I'm suggesting that the problems that you're talking about in America can be explained away in a non-racial way. Isn't that good news? Isn't it good news to know that the disproportionate number of blacks being killed by the police has to do with our crime rate and not because the police are racist? Isn't that good news? And then shouldn't we start tackling what's going on with our families that's causing all of this stuff? Instead of that being the reaction, I'm a sellout. I'm a self-loather. I hate myself. I'm an Uncle Tom. I've never been called the N-word. I've never been arrested by the police. These are the kinds of things that people say, and by the way, which are not true. I've been called the N-word. Anybody my age has been called the N-word. And yes, I was arrested once for mouthing off to an officer. I was young and impetuous, and frankly, I got what I deserved. So I've never had the impression that the police are out to get people. That's never been my personal experience, and the data do not support it. One more quick thing. There's a city here in California called Rialto. Rialto is about 100,000 people. It is as diverse as is California. And the police department was ordered to have their officers wear body cams. The officers were reluctant to do it. They didn't want to do it, but they did it and announced the program to the city. So civilians knew that cops they encountered were going to have body cams. What happened? Officer use of force fell 50%. Officer complaint fell 90%. Now, a superficial reaction to that would be, well, the cameras changed the behavior of both the civilian and the police officer. Au contraire, the police behaved as they were trained. As the camera demonstrates, they behaved as they were trained. People stopped lying on the police. They stopped making false complaints. They stopped resisting because they knew they were being filmed. It is a crime to falsely accuse the police of engaging in police brutality when they didn't do it. And it is also a crime to assault a police officer. This was now being taped, so officers didn't have to use deadly force or any kind of force because the civilians behaved more responsibly. What does that tell you? It tells you that people have been lying on the police. And we know in one major case the police relied on, in the Michael Brown Ferguson case. That's the case where Michael Brown allegedly was running away from the officer saying, my hands are up, don't shoot. His friend, Dorian Johnson, is the one who said that he said that. It turns out it was not true. And it started this whole effort about hands up, don't shoot. It's a mantra you're still hearing, and the whole thing was a lie. That's how frequently people lie on the police. By and large, the police are trying to do the best job. It is a department of government that is arguably the most scrutinized. You have internal audit. You have a civilian review. You have the DA locally. You have the state attorney. You have the feds. You have the media. You have the aggressive defense bar, the ACLU. It is arguably the most watched, over-inspected agencies we have in our country because of the awesome responsibility that they have. They have the ability to take your life, and as a result, we ought to be scrutinizing them, and we do.
So what do you make of this new executive order that the president just recently signed ostensibly around police reform and so forth?
Well, I think of it as I think of gun control measures that occur once there's a mass shooting. Do something, do something, do something. Politicians are pressured by the public to do something. And the Republican Party and Trump felt pressured to do something. But the principal thing that this executive order did was to suggest that departments ban the use of the so-called chokehold or carotid hold. Well, most departments have already banned it, except in the case of using it to save the officer's life so the officer doesn't have to resort to a firearm. That's the policy here in LA. That's been the policy of big cities all over the country for years. So I'm not sure it's going to do a whole lot other than give the American people the impression that Trump cares about this issue and he's enacting on it. The reason Trump seems awkward is because he doesn't believe the premise. The premise is that the police are engaging in systemic racism against blacks. He doesn't believe it because it's not true, and as a result, it's hard for him to sound phony and go, oh, this is horrible, this is a reflection of our racism, the way Obama would do. Obama would talk about racism is in America's DNA, and Obama said the Cambridge police acted stupidly. Obama said that we have our own troubles. There's a place called Ferguson. Obama invited Black Lives Matter to come in. And Trump is not doing any of those things because he does not accept the premise. He rejects the idea that the police are out to get black people, and as a result, he's not making any sweeping statements because they would come across as being insincere, and they would have been insincere.
You know, so many things you just made me think of in these last few sentences.
Me too. I should listen to myself more often. One time a caller called up and I lost my train of thought. I said, I'm sorry, I forgot where I was. I wasn't listening.
Well, so you tackle the idea of systemic racism directly in the film. I think, you know, one of the scenes in the film is this kind of, I guess, famous now interview that you did with Dave Rubin, where on camera he kind of realizes that he doesn't get what he means about systemic racism himself. Why are we still talking about systemic racism if, as you've argued, there really aren't many real examples of it?
Because it advances the agenda of a lot of people. It advances the agenda of the media. I think a lot of people in the media went into the profession because of Woodward and Bernstein. In the 70s, they're the ones that exposed Richard Nixon and the all the stuff he was doing. And a lot of people went into journalism because they wanted to be a champion, right the wrongs. You know, afflict the term? Comfort the afflicted and afflict the comforted or something like that. And so I think a lot of young people truly believe that have gone into the media that racism remains a major problem in America. They're around a lot of other young people and they all say the same thing, so they're all having these feelings reinforced. I also think that it sells copies. If you run stories about George Floyd being a microcosm of the racism in America, it sells copies. Racism sells. It also advances the interests of academia. There are a whole bunch of professors that are professors of African-American studies, professors of ethnic studies, and where are they going to go if all of a sudden people realize that race has never been more insignificant in terms of becoming successful in America? Where are these people going to go? And it, of course, advances the agenda of the Democrat Party, because without getting black people angry and stirred up over the assertion that racism remains a major problem, and by the way, these Republicans over there don't give a damn about that, and we do, without doing that, the Democrats don't get that 90-95% nearly monolithic black vote without which they cannot win at the presidential level. So they have to constantly talk about race and racism, and they have to go after people like Candace Owens and Larry Elder and Walter Williams and Clarence Thomas and Herman Cain and Alan West, because they reflect the antithesis of what the Democratic Party stands for. The Democratic Party stands for you are a victim and we're here to help you. And black conservatives are saying, not only are we not victims, but many of your policies are hurting the very people you claim to help. Take the minimum wage. Study after study has shown that what it does is cause employers to defer hiring decisions, reduce hours of people, or raise prices on the very people who are going to be buying things in the inner city that don't have a great deal of money. These things are counterproductive. The welfare state is counterproductive for the reasons that I just now mentioned. You're incentivizing women to marry the government and allowing men to abandon their financial and moral responsibility, and that's why we have this 70% out of wedlock birth rate right now. Not doing anything about illegal immigration hurts. George Borjas is the Harvard economist that's probably done more work on the impact of legal and illegal immigration than maybe any other economist. He says, no question that unskilled illegal aliens compete for jobs that otherwise would be held by black and brown unskilled Americans and puts downward pressure on their wages. We're not even having that discussion. So for a black conservative to raise these kinds of issues, and again, instead of this igniting a healthy discussion about whether or not we ought to be advocating tighter borders and whether or not we ought to be voting for the party that does that, people like myself are denounced as Uncle Toms and sellouts. The word that I dislike the most is not Uncle Tom, not bootlicker, not bug-eyed bootlicker, not bug-eyed foot-shuffling bootlicker, not coconut, not Oreo, not the Antichrist. I've been called all those things. The word that I fear the most is being called wrong. And rarely am I called wrong. Am I wrong about my assertion of the welfare state and the proliferation of kids being raised without fathers? Am I wrong about the competition posed by unskilled illegal aliens to black people? Am I wrong about government schools producing kids that cannot read, write, and compute at grade level? Am I wrong about these things? If I'm wrong, show me how I'm wrong. But when you call me an Uncle Tom, it shows me you have no ammo, and we're not having the discussion that advances the best interests of the people you claim to care about.
So it's basically the name calling is a way to just stop the discussion.
Shut the conversation down, because they need to have that power. That's why Joe Biden recently said to a black interviewer, hey, if you don't know whether or not you want to vote for me or Trump by now, you ain't black. Now, people criticized him and he apologized for making the statement, but all he was doing is articulating a basic premise of the Democratic Party, that if you don't think a certain way, you're a sellout. If you don't think a certain way, you lack compassion for your own people. Hell, last year, Ayanna Pressley, who's one quarter of the so-called squad, publicly said, we don't need any more brown faces who don't want to be a brown voice. We don't need any more black faces who don't want to be a black voice. What does that say other than what Joe Biden said, and that is there's only one way to be black, and that's to be left-wing and vote for the Democrats? It is a standard position of the Democratic Party. I'll give you a more glaring example. In the mid-90s, there was a proposition in California called Proposition 209 to get rid of the use of race and gender in public admissions to colleges and universities, in government hiring, and in issuing contracts. You can't use race as a factor. And it passed overwhelmingly in California. It was led by a black man named Ward Connerly, who happened to be married to a white woman. Ward Connerly was a small businessman who didn't like the whole idea of these set-asides for black people. So he campaigned and successfully got rid of race-based preferences. He had an opponent, a political opponent named Diane Watson, who later on ran for and got elected to U.S. House of Representatives. At the time, she was a local lawmaker. She said this publicly, Jan, publicly. Let me tell you why you support this proposition. You're married to a white woman. You have no ethnic pride. You don't want to be white. You hate being black. And then when she was asked about it by reporters, she said, that's right, I said it, and I don't take it back. To this day, she never held it back. Holy David Duke. Who can say something like that publicly and get away with it? She did, because she's a Democrat. Because the Democrats don't want a colorblind society, they want a color-coordinated society, and they're the ones who do the coordinating. That's what's going on here. This complete rejection of MLK's message of a colorblind society. They don't want that. They want to have the power to determine who gets what and where and why based upon skin color, not based upon diversity of ideology, based upon skin color.
So, you know, it's interesting because you, in the film, you talk about, for example, there's this, I think we could call him the main character, Chad, mm-hmm. right? I love watching his kind of journey throughout the film. So he's talking about, you know, looking at the Democratic versus the Republican platform and so forth. But I think like the concepts you're talking about are kind of much deeper than party, right?
Well, they are, and that is why the viciousness is so over the top. The man you're talking about is named Chad, and Chad has a contracting company, and he is not a politician. He doesn't have sharp elbows. He's not angry. He's not in your face. He's just a regular guy trying to make it in America as a small businessman. He's religious, and he said one of his friends encouraged him, because he was saying such anti-things about the Democratic Party, to read the platform of the Democratic Party and the platform of the Republican Party. He had never done that. So he took him up on the challenge. And after he read both platforms, he said, damn, I'm Republican. I believe in low taxes. I believe in less regulation. I believe in personal responsibility. And the movie is about the reaction he got from friends and family that didn't say, what caused you to rethink your assumptions? What material have you looked at? He was denounced by friends and family as an Uncle Tom and a sellout. And so the movie simply follows his life, his career, and his journey, and what caused him to begin to rethink some of his assumptions. All the movie asks is that in America, don't you have the right to have your own opinion? Especially if it's a well-thought-out opinion. And why would you have a well-thought-out opinion be denounced because of your race as reflective of a sellout, of somebody who's an Uncle Tom who wishes bad things to happen to fellow members of his own race? What is the logic behind that? And why is this going on? And isn't this hurting the country? That's what the movie asks.
So Larry, something just comes to my mind now. Something that struck me as really bizarre recently is this removal by HBO Max of Gone with the Wind, possibly one of the most famous films of all time, one of the better films, out of rotation, ostensibly because it's racist. Your thoughts?
It's part of what some people call the cancel culture. I don't call it that. I call it the revenge culture. The idea that you're going to go around and find all the things that offend you from the sensibilities of somebody living in 2020. And it's absurd. The film was made in 1939, the year that all these amazing films came out. It was considered to be cutting edge in cinematography, cutting edge in dialogue at the end of the film when Clark Gable says, frankly, I don't give a damn. That shocked people because no one had ever used a D word on movies before. I didn't see the movie until I was in my 30s. And the reason I never saw it is because I never really wanted to. I knew that it was a movie that portrayed the South in kind of a beautiful way and the mansions in kind of a beautiful way, and I thought it probably soft-pedaled slavery. So for all those reasons, I, Larry Elder, was never interested in seeing it. I also knew it was a long movie. I got short attention span. I got to go. I know my mother loved the movie. My father, as far as I know, had no opinion of it one way or the other, but I know my mom liked it. Now, the reason I saw it is I was dating somebody who told me it was the greatest film she'd ever seen. And I said, I'm surprised that anybody black feels that way about it. She goes, oh, I think it's a movie. I love the story. I love the way the South used to be, and it's about how it changed because of the Civil War. And I said, okay. So I watched it. Film's long. Film is long. And I thought it was an entertaining film, an enjoyable film. I wasn't offended by it. I didn't think it romanticized slavery, but it certainly did not take a harsh condemnation of it. And why anybody would find that so offensive that it would be taken out of rotation and apparently going to be replaced with a disclaimer that some of these images are offensive is beyond me. We know some of the images are offensive. You want to take off Tarzan because the white guy swinging through the jungle on a vine and basically runs the place? When do you want to stop doing that kind of stuff? I understand that Obama's mom's side owned slaves. His father's side came from an area of Africa where there was a great deal of slave trading. I don't know whether his family was involved in it, but certainly people from that part of the country where his dad is from, of Africa, was involved. So you could argue that Obama has his hands involved in slavery on his mom's side and on his dad's side. Should we remove Obama's name from every building around? It is sickening. And I understand there's a movement to get rid of the Washington Monument, get rid of the Jefferson Memorial, because both Washington and Jefferson owned slaves. You know, nobody owns slaves now. And the whole reparations movement is, in my opinion, an attempt to extract money from people who are never slave owners to be given to people who are never slaves. What is the purpose of all of this? Is it going to make the 70% of black kids being born outside of wedlock go away? Is it going to do something about the 50% dropout rate in some of our inner city high schools and the fact that many of these kids who do graduate cannot read, write, and compute at grade level? Is it going to solve the fact that among young black men, 25% of them have a criminal record, either arrested in jail or on parole or on probation? Is it going to solve any of these things? And if the goal is to make black people feel better about themselves, we already feel good about ourselves. Look at self-esteem tests over the last 30 years. Every single time I've seen any of these tests, it almost always shows black people have higher self-esteem than white people, much higher self-esteem than Asians. Black girls have much higher self-esteem than white girls who are obsessed with a Barbie doll image. And black girls are far more realistic about the variety in their body shapes and feel much more confident about who they are. So if the goal is to make black people feel better, mission accomplished. So I'm not sure what the purpose of it is other than revenge, getting back. That's why I believe O.J. Simpson was cut loose. One of the jurors years later was interviewed. Her name was Bessie Cass, and she was asked about the verdict. And she said, I'm paraphrasing, I voted not guilty because of Rodney King. And the filmmaker was gobsmacked. And if the whole film, the filmmaker never said a word, but this one he couldn't help himself. He said, did the others feel that way too? You hear him say it, you don't see him, but you hear his voice. And she said, 90% of us did. Revenge for Rodney King. This is revenge for slavery, revenge for Jim Crow, revenge for every slight that you ever felt that you received. And it's called the revenge culture, not the cancel culture. And that's what this is all about. And it's absurd. When and where does it stop? It perpetuates the notion that I'm somehow a victim. I'm not a victim.
So, okay, so what is the connection between this revenge culture that you're describing and the victim culture, let's say, and that actually features very prominently in Uncle Tom?
Well, it's all the feeling that because of the historical past of America, because of slavery, because of Jim Crow, black people are unequal, net worth unequal, and all these things are true. The question is, in order for you to get more, is it appropriate morally, legally, politically, to accuse somebody of having benefited from slavery and from Jim Crow, and therefore, as a beneficiary, you owe me money, you should pay me something? That seems to be what the ethos is. All a state can be is just in its own time. And again, Obama gets elected in 2008. I'm old school, Jan. I used to get the LA Times, the New York Times thrown to my house. The next morning, I go get the newspapers, and on the front pages of both newspapers, there were big color pictures of parents, black parents hugging their kids, saying, I can now, for the first time, credibly say, you can be anything you want to be. I can now say it and mean it. I've always said it, they said, but I never really meant it.
This is with the election of President Obama.
Yeah, I always had my fingers crossed when I said it. All these parents pretty much said that. And I remember reading it and saying to myself, wow, what would these parents have said had Obama lost? My mother always told me I could be anything I wanted to be, and I always believed her. So I think we're hurting our kids by peddling this notion that you're a victim, by peddling this notion that you should exact revenge on people who did nothing whatever to do with you, because it's then taking time and energy away from things we ought to be doing. I recently posted on Twitter a graph showing the amount of homework done by Asian kids, the amount of homework done by white kids, the amount of homework done every night by Hispanic kids, the amount of homework done every night by black kids. Now, what does this have to do with institutional racism? How is a white bigot preventing you from doing two good hard hours of homework every single night, which is what the Asian kids are doing? There's a correlation between how much work you put into something and what you get out of it. They certainly understand that when it comes to sports. You frequently will watch black kids being told by their coaches, hit the boards, hit the boards, hit those free throws. 500 free throw shots every day, doing these kinds of drills all the time. But you don't find the same kind of discipline when it comes to math and science and English and literature. We get the connection between hard work and sports. We don't seem to get the connection between hard work and success in life. And this is the kind of thing that I'm hoping the movie will create a healthy dialogue about.
Larry, this is fascinating, what you're describing. And you know, you contend, as the film contends, that there's no such thing as systemic racism. But I'm finding myself thinking, as you're just saying what you're saying, that maybe it does actually exist, but in a different direction than people typically think.
Well, and that's an excellent point. I have said that there is systemic racism, but not the kind of systemic racism you think. When you compel a parent to send a kid to my former high school, Crenshaw High School, where there was a front page LA Times article a couple years ago noting that only 3% of the kids at my former high school can do math at grade level, and where Ice-T, who told me he attended my former high school, Crenshaw High School, because he wanted to go to a Crip school, that's the name of the gang that controls that school. What responsible parent sends their kid to a school where only 3% of the kids can do math at grade level, and by the way, a school that is run by the Crips? And the answer is nobody would. But you are mandated to send your kid there because of the way our public education system is set up. The Republican Party wants to give that urban parent a voucher so that parent can take that kid any school that the kid can get in. Now, if you're mandated to send your kid to an inferior, underperforming government school, it seems to me that's systemic racism. If you are incentivizing women to marry the government, and allowing men to abandon their financial moral responsibility and causing a proliferation of black kids being born outside of wedlock with all the attendant social ills, that is systemic racism. If you are doing nothing about policing the border so that more and more illegal aliens come to America and take jobs that would otherwise be held by unskilled black and brown workers and puts pressure on their wages, that is systemic racism. But that's not what the left means when they talk about systemic racism. They're talking about hostile anti-black attitudes that allegedly pervade America, when again the data shows the contrary.
You know, Larry, so speaking of, you know, this victim culture, victim mentality, one of the things I noticed in the film, Carol Swain describes how she only learned that she was poor and disadvantaged while in college.
Right.
Which I just, it threw my mind for a loop.
From a liberal professor, she said.
Yeah.
Who told her when she said something the professor didn't like, well, you're never going to be able to do something about the fact that you're black. And she was kind of surprised by that, since this person purported to be a liberal. And if you think about the policies of the left, they really are suggesting that you as a black person really can't measure up. Why, after all, would you want to lower the required SAT scores for a black person unless you feel the black person can't score high enough on the SAT on his own? It is really very condescending. I was on a plane ride once with a man who was a prominent Democrat politician in Cleveland when I lived there. He was a commissioner, I'm not gonna say his name. And we were on the plane together, having a couple of pops. He had more pops than I had. And I asked him, don't many people in your party really feel that black people can't compete on their own? That's why you support affirmative action. I don't believe he would have responded the way he did had he not had a couple of pops. And he said, yeah, I know a lot of people that really believe black people just really are inferior and they're not good enough. That's why we have to change the rules. I'm not sure he would have said that had he been sober, but he said that. And that really is the assumption, isn't it? We have to change the rules. We don't adjust the basketball hoop for white people. We don't make the race longer or shorter for white people. Why are we changing the rules over here for black people? When I get on an airplane and I see a black pilot, I don't want to know about affirmative action. I want to make sure that this guy aced his pilot exam, and he's there because he's the most competent pilot that I could possibly have. When you wheel your mom into the ER room and you see a black doctor, do you want to think in the back of your mind, did he get into medical school because he was black? Did he get through because he was black? These have real world consequences, and we ought to be talking about the best and the brightest, and we ought to be determining who gets what based upon the content of their character and not based upon the color of their skin.
Well, so that's also really interesting because it makes me think of another kind of element in the film where you're talking about Booker T. Washington, which is, you know, frankly, someone that I just wasn't aware of until a few years ago. And frankly, that whole time period, and this is one of Bob Woodson's, who I recently had on the show, of course, it features prominently in the film, argument that, you know, kind of post-slavery under Jim Crow, black America actually did pretty well for itself.
Mm-hmm.
And it's right. Remarkable. And then we're using this ethos of Booker T. Washington.
Booker T. Washington wrote a book called Up From Slavery in 1901. Now think about that. That's 36 years after slavery. He was born a slave. And if you read the book, he's more optimistic about the future for black people than some of our so-called black leaders are right now. And his argument was work hard, put time into it, become of value to your community. And once you do that, people want the best and they will come to you and it will be the path towards your door. He had an ideological opponent named W.E.B. Du Bois, who felt that we ought to be pursuing integration with white people. Du Bois became a communist, renounces American citizenship, and is now, in my opinion, a historical footnote, whereas Booker T. Washington's Tuskegee Institute still exists, and his philosophy of hard work and accountability, in my opinion, is what we all ought to be embracing, no matter your race in America.
Yeah, I mean, it's, again, so there's a whole, all these, I guess, characters in the film, let's say, that a lot of us, you know, maybe not, aren't so familiar with, Walter Williams, Thomas Sowell, Clarence Thomas, of course. I mean, I hope every American knows who Clarence Thomas is.
Well, Jan, the reason a lot of blacks don't know who Clarence Thomas is and don't know who Walter Williams is and don't know who Thomas Sowell is, the most prominent publication for blacks historically has been Ebony Magazine. I cannot remember a time when an Ebony Magazine, the current issue, was not on the coffee table in my parents' house. That's how influential it was. They had a feature every year called the 100 Most Influential Black Americans. And it would have people in there like MLK and so forth. Because so many blacks became so prominent, they had to upgrade it to the 100 plus Most Influential Black Americans. That's what it is last time I checked. And every year, absent in the list of the 100 most prominent black Americans, absent are Clarence Thomas, absent are Walter Williams, absent are Thomas Sowell. Now, Clarence Thomas is only one of 9 members of the Supreme Court. By definition, he's influential, yet he's not in this publication. Thomas Sowell was described by David Mamet, the playwright, as America's most important contemporary philosopher, whom he credits with helping to change him from being a brain-dead liberal. And Walter Williams, to my knowledge, is the first and I think only economics chairman of a non-historically black college or university. Both Thomas Sowell and Walter Williams collectively have probably written about 60 books. And most black Americans don't know who they are, in part because of the way they are treated by the black media that completely excludes them and acts as if they don't even exist. And it's an absolute outrage. And I address that to some extent in this film.
So let's talk about actually Black Lives Matter. So, this is important to me. I mean, Black Lives Matter on the face of it. Of course, Black Lives Matter. They matter to me. I hope they matter to most Americans. And then, of course, there's the Black Lives Matter, the organization. I won't even say the movement, because I think a lot of the people in the movement are for Black Lives Matter, the concept, right? And I know you've studied Black Lives Matter quite a bit. Can you kind of give a thumbnail of what this group is about?
Well, the whole movement, it didn't start because of Ferguson. It started before that, but it certainly got a big spin because of Ferguson. And it was a movement that started based upon the assumption that the police are engaging in systemic racism against Black people. If the premise is bad, the movement is bad, and the organization is bad. And the premise is bad, and the movement is bad, and the organization is bad. And the organization, by the way, is not just about Black Lives Matter. One of their principal statements refers to Israel as an apartheid state and consider the Palestinians to be oppressed. So it's a left-wing movement that's hostile, in my opinion, to the values that made this country great, and it's built upon this phony narrative that the police are out to get Black people, when in fact the studies show the opposite. Now, it's one thing just to have a stupid point of view. Lots of people have stupid points of view that are harmless. This is harmful. It causes young Black men, when they're stopped by the police, to become far more confrontational than they otherwise would be. After all, why not be confrontational? If you believe the man pulling you over is going to do you ill, why be cooperative? I understand that. It also causes the cops to pull back and become less proactive because they're afraid of being called racist. So what happens? Crime goes up in the very same area that the Black Lives Matter activists claim that they care about. So it's undermining the country, it is inconsistent with the best interests of Black people, and it's built upon a lie.
So what would you say to the millions, ostensibly, of people of all different shapes and stripes and colors that do care genuinely about Black lives and feel there's an issue at this point? We saw them on the streets, a lot of them on the streets peacefully protesting and so forth.
Well, most of them were there with the best of intentions. They're just wrong. Watching too much CNN, watching too much MSNBC, reading too much New York Times. Read some conservative publications. Read Heather McDonald. Probably nobody has done a better job of assembling all the data on police and police interaction with civilians than Heather McDonald. Read the police public contact survey. That's something that the DOJ does every 3 years. They ask over 60,000 Americans, in the last year, did you have contact with the police? If so, tell me about your contact. Were you verbally abused? Were you physically abused? They can't find any evidence whatsoever of a pattern of abuse against Black people. It's not like the government doesn't care about this. They've been looking at it. There's a study that came out during the Obama administration called Race and Traffic Stops, something like that. It was published by the National Institutes of Justice, which is the research arm of the DOJ. And they tried to find out whether or not Black people were being pulled over because of racism. And they found out 75% of Black motorists admitted that they were stopped for a legitimate reason. And the other big takeaway is that you name the offense, whether it's speeding, driving without a license, driving without your headlights, driving without an expired tag, you name the offense, a Black motorist was more likely to do it. And again, isn't this good news to know that the disproportionate Blacks being pulled over have to do with behavior and not because of racism? And again, that study came out in 2013. There was an allegation years ago that the police were pulling over Black motorists on the New Jersey Turnpike. The then governor, Christy Todd Whitman, ordered a study. Study came in, and they found out officers couldn't even tell the race. The cars are going too fast, there's a reflection off the lights, and at night, forget about it, you can't even tell who's in the car. So they concluded that the reason Black people were being pulled over is because the faster the speed, the more likely it is it's a Black driver driving. She didn't like the results. She complained about bad methodology. Hired a different group with different methodology. Same result. Not there. The data just do not support that. Isn't this good news? And by the way, it doesn't mean there aren't bad cops. When a cop kills somebody, no matter his race or her race, that should be investigated by the feds. They have awesome power and they should be watched. But the idea that there's some sort of systemic pattern simply is not borne out by the data. If it were, I wouldn't say what I said. I don't want the police to have a free rein and go after Black people any more than anybody else does. It just isn't there. You're making things worse.
So tell us a little more. When is the film coming out?
The film called Uncle Tom is coming out on June the 19th. And in order to order it, we're putting it online. Go to UncleTom.com and be the first in your hood to get some Uncle Tom merch.
So, and you know, it's a provocative name.
It is.
I mean, as I said, I'm not even sure I should say that. I should use those words.
Well, it's of a provocative name, and the reason I've called it that is because we are often called Uncle Tom. And by the way, a lot of people have never read the book, the novel by Harriet Beecher Stowe. Uncle Tom was actually a hero of the book. The villain was a guy named Sambo. So whenever anybody calls a black person Uncle Tom, it tells you they never read the book. It tells you something about their education K through 12 and why we need vouchers.
Any final words before we finish up?
The final word would be this. The movie is not a vindictive film. It's not an angry film. It's not a film that says, how dare you? It's a film that simply takes you on a journey of what happens when a person without any kind of political vendetta, without any kind of anger, simply suggests that maybe, just maybe, I should be thinking about a different party than the one that my race has traditionally supported. And it talks about what happens to this gentleman because of this. And it raises a very important question, is why can't we have a healthy discussion in the black community without dissenting views being denounced as coming from an Uncle Tom?
Larry Elder, such a pleasure to have you again.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me. Thank you for allowing me to borrow your audience.